Good morning and welcome to All Saints Online Sunday Service. My name is Reverend Bob, and here today I'll be joining by my colleague Mike Coates, who will be sharing the Word of God with us. And then John Hughes will lead us into a moment of intercessory prayers. So wherever you are tuning from, we are delighted that you're able to join in. I pray and believe that there's a reason why you have joined today. I pray that you will come with an open heart to receive through the song worship, through the sharing of the word, through the intercessory prayers, that in that you will encounter him in a powerful way. Friends, whatever you're going through this morning, the Lord knows. You might be struggling in many ways, but I want to assure you that God knows, because he says he will never leave us nor forsake us. He will be with us. You might not be able to see it right now, but he is right there with you. Allow him to speak to your heart. Let us pray as we begin our worship this day. We worship a God of promise, whose saving grace brought a people from captivity into a land of promise, whose enduring love still leads us from place of captivity into promise of peace, forgiveness, and eternal life. The promises of God endures forever. The promises of God, friends, will be fulfilled regardless of the situations we are in right now. In his name we pray. Amen. And so, if you're able, please do join me to sing our first song, The Splendor of the King, Clothed in Majesty.
The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. Trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God. Thank you.
splendor of our King, clothed in majesty. How great is our God! How great is our God! Amen to that. Now, I don't know about you, but sometime I have sinned against God, against my friends, my neighbors, to those that I serve, knowingly and unknowingly. And Christ calls us to constantly reflect on self and come back into a moment of confession to say, actually, God, I acknowledge that I am not as I think sometimes I am to other people, even to you. And therefore, I am sorry. And so, friends, in a little while, the words will appear on the screen. Join with me to say these prayers. And as we say them, we mean it. And we are saying to God, here I am. I am sorry for the things I've done. I'm sorry for when I've thought thoughts that are not worthy of praise. I'm sorry. So friends, now come, let us return to the Lord and say, Lord our God, in our sin we have avoided your call. Our love for you is like a morning cloud, like the dew that goes away early. Have mercy on us, deliver us from judgment, bind up our wounds and revive us. In Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And so as forgiven children of God, why don't you sing with me once again, Great are you, Lord.
Are you, Lord?
Great is our God indeed. Great are you, Lord. We give you glory and honor and praise and adoration. It's now our time for Bible reading, which will be taken from the book of Judges, an Old Testament book here. Chapter 6, verses 11 to 18. Judges chapter 6, verses 11 to 18. The call of Gideon.
The Bible reading is taken from Judges chapter 6, starting at verse 11, and is taken from the Message version of the Bible. One day the angel of God came and sat down under the oak in Ophrah, and that belonged to Joash the Abrazite, whose son Gideon was threshing wheat in a winepress, out of sight of the Midianites. The angel of God appeared to him and said, "God is with you, O mighty warrior." And Gideon replied, "With me, my master? If God is with us, why has all this happening to us? Where are all the miracle wonders our parents and grandparents told us about? Didn't God deliver us from Egypt? The fact is, God has nothing to do with us. He has turned us over to Midian." But God faced him directly. Go in this strength that is yours. Save Israel from Midian. Haven't I just sent you?" Gideon said to him, "Me? My master, how and with what could I ever save Israel? Look at me. My clan's the weakest in Manasseh, and I have the runt of the litter." God said to him, "I'll be with you. Believe me, you'll defeat Midian as one man." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to this part of our service, which is the talk. And I'm really excited about talking about Gideon. In fact, I'm so excited, and please don't tell this to anybody, I'm doing it the wrong week. It should be next week. But I'd already written my talk before I realised the error I would do. Now, the other thing is that you might notice that, again, I'm outside. And just to give you a quick view outside at the front of the worship centre, simply because it struck me that the garden that's been made, which is beautiful and wonderful and lovely by Valerie and her team, also could come to represent something of a wine press. I've always loved the story of Gideon. I think because at the heart of who he is a normal human reaction to the seemingly impossible and sometimes ridiculous things God calls us to do. It's as if, it's as if God knows what he's doing, and we're full of doubt and with fear and then doubt again, and then we ignore him for a bit and then we're full of doubt again. And it's in these ordinary human reactions that we find Gideon. Now, a while ago, we were lucky enough to be able to go on a short holiday. And I don't know about what life is like when you get your holiday stuff together, but for us, it's pretty chaotic. In fact, fairly mad. And as we packed the car and we were on the way out, I suddenly realised I'd got nothing to read, so I grabbed a book. And when we got to the destination, and fortunately we had some sunshine, and I'm sat outside with a cup of tea and began to think about this book and pick it up to read, I found that I'd got a commentary on Gideon written by a guy called Jeff Lucas. Now, before you're all pulling your faces and going, ugh, he writes it like a story. So it's written as if you are reading a book, not like you're reading a traditional commentary. And it's beautiful and wonderfully written and really insightful, and uses imagination and historical fact to back up what he's saying. I absolutely thoroughly recommend it to you. Anyway, I'm reading through this book and I'm taking 20 pages or so. And so by about day three, I open page 62. And the only words written on that page say, "If your current address is the wine press, it's time to vacate it and move on. If your current address is the wine press, it's time to vacate it and move on." How did God know? That's just how I feel. That's just how I think the church feels at the moment. What does it mean, it's time to move on? Oh no, God's speaking, and when he speaks, it means something mad or ridiculous or something seemingly impossible is sure to happen. Let's dive back into the beginning and start by looking at who Gideon is and the circumstances of his life in what I've called BAG, B-A-G, before the angel of God, and glints into how things changed through that encounter. Oh, by the way, because I'm sat outside, it's raining, joyful English weather, and hence from time to time you might just get a glimpse of an umbrella that I'm sat under. Bonkers, I know. Anyway, Gideon lived about 150 years after the nation that he is part of took part possession of the promised land through God's calling on first Moses and then Joshua. He lived in Ophrah, a city that was part of the tribe of Manasseh, one of the 12 tribes of Israel, one of the lesser tribes of Israel. And in fact, he could trace his family right back to Joseph, one of the heroes of God's chosen people. Whilst Gideon clearly loved a lifestyle of some privilege, he also clearly lived in his father's shadows. In cultural terms, he was a nobody. Yes, a nobody with servants, but nevertheless, a nobody. And in fact, he calls himself a runt of the litter in the Message version that we read, or if you were to read the NIV, the least in my family. Now, whilst he clearly had a knowledge of Hebrew faith, his father Joash was the keeper of the worship places for the god Baal. High places were set, as the description says, so everyone could see them. These were the places people went to worship the god Baal. And in those high places were Asherah poles, in effect sticks about 4 feet high with figures of the deity Baal to help them in their worship as well. And Joash was responsible for looking after them. His job came with wealth and status, and he got on really well with the fat cats and the divas in the city. He had status and position. And there was a time when the whole area was dominated by Israel. They seemed clearly blessed by God. And yet now their once beaten enemies seemed like they were in charge. It was as if the blessings that God had given to Israel had been taken from them and given through Baal to their neighbors. And so the area was dominated by previous enemies of Israel. The Midianites feared for their appalling violence and skills in warfare, with vast armies on camels. The Amalekites, persistent, strong, attacking with vengeance in their hearts. And the Canaanites, with control over the iron, their chariots and weapons stronger than anyone else's. And all these people were queuing up to take the harvest, to steal and kill, and to take revenge with vicious violence. And the gods that they follow, Baal and Anat and Resheph, seemed the source of their strength, as their followers seemed to live with the blessings once held by Israel. And now Joash, remember Gideon's dad, hoped for the same blessings as he lived as a Hebrew worshipper of Baal. Believing that any chance of blessing from God had gone, after all, as Gideon said, God's not interested in us. And so slowly, one step at a time, the people of God had ignored their charge from the opening of the commandments given to them through Moses by God. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself any images in the form of anything in heaven or on earth. You shall not bow down and worship them. I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God. The thing is, of course, the true enemy of Israel was not the feared camel riders or persistent attacks for the harvest, but the true enemy was themselves. These attacks were simply symptoms of a deeper illness. These armies, vast and superior, had been beaten once upon a time by the judge Deborah. Psalm 20 verse 7 says, some trust in chariots, some in horses, but we trust in the name of the Lord our God. Well, not anymore, or so it seems. It's like a depressingly similar trek in an ever-decreasing circle of personal destruction. The people rebelled against God, causing distance from God's protection and love, and life without God meant no blessing from him, and life was then hard and sometimes violent, and God's warning was unheeded. And then a realization of the need to repent, of bringing life with God again. And so the people repented, and God was involved in their life again. And then, before you knew it, he was away from God. Sorry, the joys of sitting outside. In our passage, Gideon is in a winepress, hiding from the violent neighbors, fearful that they would come and take the harvest, and with it his life and the lives of many others. On this day, he joined everyone else to bring in the harvest, a frantic, dangerous task, something that would ensure the survival of his city for another year. And the wine presses were set into the land so they were harder to see. And if you were going to thresh corn, where would you go? Well, not the wine press, obviously, so that was Gideon's thinking. And no food, of course, meant devastation, but then the hordes of warriors waiting to attack, to murder, to destroy and steal, meant hiding, because who was going to fight for them? In Gideon's head, God? I think not. And that was life for Gideon Bag. And then he was presented with an angel from God, and his life changed. Now, it's easy to shake our heads in disbelief as we read the constant falling into sin of God's chosen people. But what about us? Should we be so quick to point and judge? Didn't Jesus talk about a plank in our own eye? Maybe there's a thing, something that we've been wrestling with for a while, that we keep going back to, the same cycle of rebellion against God. That's something. Maybe it's an addiction. Maybe something we're ashamed of, something deep inside us we simply have never really given to God or recognized that we need help with. Or maybe for us, a slow but sure small steps away from God, listening to the world, not God, finding as we do, it's easier and easier to step away from God's love and protection as we continue this same cycle, doing it, asking for forgiveness, living with God, doing it, asking for forgiveness, living with God. So however we see our lives, I want to make a point first of all. I don't believe that there is any one of us who can put our hands on our hearts and say, despite our best efforts, we have never wandered away from God. Jesus gave a picture of listening Jews of a pigsty, the place furthest away from God. The further we get from God, the easier it is to eat with the pigs, and the easier it is to live as the world says, the easier it is to do that thing that becomes those things that become acceptable, that move us step by step away from God's love and grace and protection. Even our asking God to forgive us becomes a simple ritual of words. And where are we left? Well, I'll tell you where we're left. We're left in a wine press, frightened, lost, lonely, full of doubt and racked with guilt. We're left in the place of Gideon, hiding from God's calling to worship only him, hiding from belief and sin and guilt. Because here in the wine press, surely it's the safest place that I can find. From time to time, we are engaged with people's lives through the work at the Hub. And there is a hostel on Lower Breck Road, and it is a disgusting, disgraceful place that needs closing immediately. It is run simply for profit and not recognized by the local authority. And it is, as I say, inside really, really awful. And the people who live there live in some sense of community. It's as though the world is against them and so will support each other. But it is racked with addiction and alcohol and drugs and all of the kind of things that you might expect in that kind of community. And we were approached by somebody who wanted to move away. And so we worked hard with them and we gave them the steps to move away. And instead of taking that first step, they turned their back on it and went back into the hostel. Again, we put in place, along with Shelter, who were brilliant, the steps to move away. Again, turn round and walk back into the hostel. Again, we put in place the steps to move away. Again, they turned their back on those steps and moved back into the hostel. And we wait patiently, hoping and praying that that person will return wanting those same steps again. Because it takes courage and faith to step out of your wine press, to stand out of that thing that draws you back into the world. It takes courage and faith to walk away from a community of people into who knows what. To trust others when all of your life you have no reason to trust anybody. It takes courage and faith to stand and come out of the winepress. And the thing is, I find myself challenged by God that I've been there too long, hiding maybe behind work or busyness or family. And I want to stand. Now, at this time, as we move from COVID lockdown to whatever a new normal is, it's hard and difficult. But that's not the winepress that I'm speaking about. And that COVID lockdown is not the thing that's holding us into it. It's not why we can't stand. And there are other things, maybe it's illness or loss, as that I'm finding in my old age, a new understanding of our use and purpose. Maybe it's poverty, struggling to feed your child is just so painful, but that's not it either. Maybe it's asylum or wrestling with an unjust or unfair system, or unjust benefit system or housing, and we could go on. All of these may have forced you into your winepress, but none of the responses to these will lift you out. It is your knowledge and love of God that lifts you and journeys with you and brings you strength and grace and hope. And as you read through the story of Gideon, he asks for confirmation again and again and again, wrestling with doubt and fear. It's not an easy thing to stand, but God knows our fears and doubts. And he responded to Gideon as he would respond to you, as he would respond and will respond to our friend in the Lower Breck Road Hostel, with patience and love. Gideon, in God's grace, moved from a frightened winepress liver to a single-minded, God-following leader and God's man. You don't believe me? Then read the rest of the story. It's in Judges 6, 7, and 8, and we'll probably take you about 15 to 20 minutes to read the whole lot. One last thing. Because as we stand, at least I'd ask, what comes next? What am I standing for? And it's likely to seem, as you've mentioned, Michael, a ridiculous, even bonkers thing that God's asks of us, something that we cannot see within ourselves. And yes, that's true. But what that thing is, well, I'm sorry, I have no idea. All I know is God is calling us to stand together. And that takes courage and faith. But what he's planned for us, I have no clue. So sorry, I can't say. Except it will be exciting and life-changing and take courage and faith and be a blessing to others as we recognize God's kingdom here on earth in the lives of those God sends us to. At times it won't be easy. It will take lots of prayer and listening. But in standing, we are being the people God wants us to be. And the people deep down inside our own selves we know we can be, walking with God, following his will, worshipping through words and action, his name being the best at being us we can be. Following God's will, worshipping through our words and our actions, God's name being the best at being us we can be. I'm going to put down my umbrella now, excuse me, because I'm going to go and stand in our garden, and I'm going to use that as our wine press. And so bear with me as I move across here, away from the tree that was protecting me from the rain, into our garden. Can you see? It seems so beautiful and lovely and wonderful. It seems so ordered. And yet, for this moment, it represents us standing together in our winepress. So let's close our eyes, put down whatever it is else we're doing, and let's pray together. Just take a big breath. Recognize God's presence. Enable his love to flood into your life. Father God, thank you for your presence with us now, wherever we are. Enable your love to shine into each one of us through your Holy Spirit. Take away our fear and doubt. And help us to recognize the winepress that we are locked into. And give us, Lord Jesus, the strength to stand together now. And if you're able, wherever you are, let's stand up. Because that's representing the moment when we stand out of our winepress. What it meant for Gideon was that he was going to be seen by those who were attacking his country. What it means for us is that we're standing up for God. And as we leave this garden, representing our winepress, this safe place, we move out into our world. As people of God, so Father God, now we are here. We are here to follow you. We are here to show your love to the world, to help people recognize the activity that you already spend around this community. Empower us, lead us, love us, protect us. Pour into us the gifts and skills that we need moment by moment. And be patient with us, Lord, as we repeatedly come back to you. In Jesus' name we pray.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love. You know each one of us by name. You know our every need. You hear our every cry. We know we can talk to you at any time. So hear us as we bring you our thoughts and be alongside us as we go through this new day. Show us your path and send your Holy Spirit to protect, comfort and guide us in everything we do. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we thank you for all the amazing blessings you have poured upon us, especially for the gift of good friends and loving families, for their care and support in good times and in bad. We place them now into your hands and ask for your blessing upon them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those in authority, for the world's leaders, that they may work for the good of all people, for our Queen and all members of the royal family, for our government, that they might have the wisdom, the understanding, and the courage to make the right choices, working towards creating a just world that reflects your laws. We pray for all those who serve in positions of authority within the church, but especially for our clergy here at All Saints. Guide, strengthen and inspire them and us by your Spirit as we obey your call to work and witness in your world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Sometimes things happen in our lives which we neither welcome nor understand, but we thank you, Father, for the hope we have in you. Be with all those whose lives are difficult at the moment, especially anyone known to us personally, who we name now before you in a few moments of silence. In their fear, be their confidence. In their weakness, be their strength. In their anxiety, be their calm. Bring your healing where there is sickness, your solace where there is grief, and your light where there is darkness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Rejoicing in your amazing generosity and extravagant love, we ask you to use each one of us in your service this coming week. Be at our side in the busyness of each day. Take our feet where they need to go. Give us willing hands that readily extend to others. Open our ears to hear, our eyes to see, and give us generous hearts to reach out to those in need. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. And now let's join together in the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you very much, Mike and John Hughes, for leading us and being part of this morning worship. And now it's time for our notices. Morning prayers, just to say that still carrying on every Monday to Friday, and then Wednesday at 7:30 as well in the evening. You can join us for that. More information in regards to how you can access our Zoom channel can be found on the church WhatsApp group, or you can actually give us a ring and we will help you to log in successfully. There are lots of other activities that will be happening, but we'll be communicating to you as time comes. But in the meantime, do access more information on our website. And if you are not able to access through the website, please do let us know so we can make sure that materials are printed out and delivered to you as well. And now, this birthday, I've been told that little Elsie has celebrated her birthday already on Friday. Happy birthday, Elsie. We pray that the good Lord will continue to take care of you as a little girl, and as you grow into that woman that he desires you to become, we pray that his presence will continue with you always. And so, happy birthday from All Saints Church. And for you who is celebrating your birthday, and perhaps I've not mentioned your name, happy birthday to you too. We love you and we care deeply for you. And now, before we sing our final song, which is Everyone Needs Compassion, which indeed everybody needs, let me say the final blessings. Lord God Almighty, thank you for the time we have spent in this place, whether it within our around our family homes, or as we journey in a car somewhere or on the train. As we close this meeting, we ask you, Lord, to walk with us everywhere we go. Help us to keep your word in our hearts, that we may not sin against you. Through Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So, brethren, wherever you are, the blessing of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you in all that you do, together with your families, always. Amen. So, go in peace to love and serve the Lord in the name of Christ. Amen. Thank you once again for joining and tuning in. God bless you. We love you. Bye-bye.
Of the Savior, the hope.